بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والصلاة والسلام على خاتم الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. ثم أما بعد، our talk today will be about humanity's need for a true religion. There are many religions in the world, but what humanity needs is a true religion. And by a true religion, we mean a religion that is a message from God. Now, the overwhelming majority of people in the world believe in God. They might call him by different names, but the basic idea, which all of them share, is that they have been created by a being who is eternal, and they are also sustained in this world by that creator. This is something that seems to be, or in fact it is, in the nature of human being. That is why you find this belief in all cultures, among all people, throughout history. This could not have come by accident. There must be something in their nature which tells them that they have a creator. Now, many of these thinking people are saying that if this God is the God who provides us with all that we need for material and bodily needs, and if this God is wise and he is all-knowing, then it is inconceivable that he should neglect to provide us with something that is more important for us, something which he himself knows that is more important for us, and that is spiritual guidance. Now, therefore, they would say to themselves, there must be a message from this God. This is something about which there should be no doubt. And given the nature of the attributes of this creator, we come to the conclusion that he must send a message to his servants in this world to guide them, to show them how to live a life of which he approves, and a life which makes them very happy. The question now is, where is this message? These thinking people will naturally start to look for the religions that are now available in the world. Now, since they are looking for a religion that is from God, they will discard religions that are confessed to be man-made, or for which even its adherents say they have no proof that this religion is from God. This leaves them with only those religions which still claim to be divine religion, to be messages from their Lord. They start to look into these religions. Now, the first question they ask about them is, what is the historical authenticity of these religions? By the historical authenticity, they mean, to what extent is it historically proven that this religion that is called Islam or Christianity or Judaism or any other religion, to what extent is it true that the message that these people have now in the world is the message which they attribute to Muhammad or Jesus or Moses? What is the historical proof of this claim? Now, almost all students of religions, all historians now, are agreed that there is no historical religion except Islam, and there is no founder of religion who is historical other than Muhammad. There is no historical proof that the books that are attributed to people other than Muhammad are really the books or the messages that those prophets convey to the people as messages from their Lord. Now, why do these students of the history of religion say this? They say it because they see all Muslims now, all over the world, read the same book, the book that is in Arabic, and they are all agreed that everything in this book is true. They don't disagree about what is in this book. All of them, all over the world, there are thousands or perhaps millions of them. And this book is also recorded, so thousands or millions of them know it by heart and can read it in the form of a book. Now, when you ask them, where did they get this book from? You go back, you find that the present generation got it from generation before it. That generation got it from a generation before it. Until you come to the time of Prophet Muhammad. All this is historically proven. Come to the time of Prophet Muhammad. And you find that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to do the following. Whenever he received a revelation from God, he used to dictate it to a few people around him. They are called scribes. They dictate whatever he tells them. So he recites it, and then they record it. More than the recording, many of them learn what they heard by heart. Why? Because those people had exceptional ability to learn by heart whatever they heard. The Arabs were like this. I mean, not particularly the Muslims. This was characteristics of the Arabs at that time. Some of them would learn by heart a whole poem, even if they heard it for the first time. So they learn what the Prophet told them. They learn by heart. They record it down. Now, then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to recite this portion of the Quran in his prayers. Many of the other Muslims hear this recitation of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They heard it from him on different occasions in his prayers. So the Quran was something that was very popular among people. Many of them, by the time the Prophet died, many of them had committed the whole Quran to memory. And it was all of it written down in different ways. It was not until that time collected in one book, but it was written down on different things. There was no paper like this at that time, so they wrote it down on different other things. So it was written down, the whole of the book. It was learned by heart by so many books. Then, at a later time, one companion of the Prophet, who was at that time the ruler, the Khalifa, collected all these portions of the Quran and put them in the form of a book. That book is the source of all the books that are written until today. It's now time for a short break, after which she will come back. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Welcome back, brothers and sisters. Remember that we are talking about humanity's need for a true religion. We said that there are only about three candidates for this kind of religion. And we said that only one of them is a historical religion. So we have to discard the other two or three. This by itself would have been enough to prove that it is this religion which is a true religion. Why? Because we started by saying that knowing God, we believe that he must send messages. And if there are only three candidates for a true message, and two of them are discarded, then the third one must be the message for which we are looking. But we said that there is more evidence that Islam is this message that we are looking for. We gave proof, or the proof that historians and students of religion give, for the fact that Islam is the historical religion. We started with the Quran. Now we go to the other source of Islam. You see, the two sources of Islam as the Quran, which is the word of God in the literal meaning. The angel Gabriel came and recited these words to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who recited them to his companions, who learned them by heart and wrote them down. But the other source of Islam is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, because God did not make the Prophet just a messenger who conveys the message, but someone who also explains it. He explains the message by word of mouth, by his deeds, which are for Muslims to emulate, by his approvals, and so on. Now, what is the proof that this Sunnah of the Prophet, this other source of religion of Islam, is also historical? This, in brief, is the proof. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used, because he knew that he was a teacher, he used to speak slowly. One of his wives said that you could count the words as they come out of his mouth. They learned by heart whatever they heard from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet encouraged them to convey to others, encouraged those who heard anything from him to convey to others, and that God would reward them for this. So they were very keen on learning by heart the words as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned them. They had great respect for him. They believed that he was a prophet from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And therefore, they learned, they were very keen, as I have just said, on conveying the words that they heard from him as he mentioned them. They were also very keen on reporting what they saw him doing. So the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not only the words that he mentioned, but also the actions that he did. And everything was reported. Now, this first generation of the companions of the Prophet reported or conveyed what they heard to the second generation in so many ways. One would tell someone else. One would tell three or four. One in the second generation would hear the same hadith, the same saying of the Prophet from two or three different companions of the Prophet, and so on, generation after generation. I forgot to say that many of the companions of the Prophet did not only commit to memory what they heard from him, but they also wrote it down. And the same happened with the second generation of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They also learned by heart what they heard and wrote down what they heard. And this went on and on like this. And now we have huge science, what you can call a science, of how the Sunnah of the Prophet was reported to us. There are so many books about every individual who reported in a series of reporters, every individual who reported what he heard from other individuals. And there are many people until now who know almost every one of these individuals. They know where he was born, how he lived, what his character was, and so on. So in this way, they could tell what if the hadith is authentic, and they had very strict standards for judging the hadith to be authentic or weak, as they said. So we have also, in this way, the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Humanity knows or can know more about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam than they can know about any individual in the world. Every aspect of his life is recorded. His private life, his public life, everything. His wives used to tell people about even his very private life, what he did at home, how he ate, how he drank, how he slept, what clothes did he wear, how he treated children, and so on. And till now, we have books describing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in these details. So this is the proof. This is the proof that this religion of Islam is the historical religion. But this is not all. There is evidence in the religion itself that it is from God. So even if we had no evidence of its historical authenticity, we would have come to the conclusion that it must be a religion from God just by looking into it and examining it. And inshallah, in the coming talks, we will give examples of the characteristics of this religion that prove that it must be a religion from God. But now we'll give just a few examples. The first example is a very important one. It's about the concept of God. The most perfect concept of God is to be found in the Quran. You don't find any concept like this in other sources, whether they be religious or philosophical. For example, the God of the philosophers is like an abstract God, someone who created the world and then left it, and who has no connection with human beings and so on. So a true God cannot be like this. The Arabs to whom the Prophet ﷺ was sent used to believe that God has daughters. So it is not only Christians who believe that God has a son or has children. The Arabs used to believe that the angels were the daughters of God. Now, the Quran told them, and this is what God himself is saying about himself, that he was neither begotten nor does he beget. Why? Because if he is the creator of everything, then he cannot be begotten for something by something else. If God is the creator of everything, he cannot be the father of anyone, because you cannot be the father of something which you create. So to say that God is creator and father is a contradiction in terms. This is something that you find mentioned in the Quran in many details. The Quran says, how come that he can be a father, seeing that he has no wife. Then about the attributes of God. You have, according to the Quran, God has the most perfect attributes. No creature can have any of the attributes of God. They can have the names, like you say, God is all-knowing, that human beings know, or that God is powerful, human beings are powerful, but there is no comparison between the nature of God's power and knowledge and the nature of human beings, God's power. Another example is that this religion is very comprehensive, and that is what you would expect from a true religion from God. If God sends us a message, it is not something that is bound to any one culture or place or time. It is a religion that is very much compatible with reason. In fact, you will find in the Quran many arguments, rational arguments, for the fundamentals of the religion. Why is there God? Why should that God alone be worshipped? What is the proof that Muhammad or Moses or Jesus are true prophets of God, and so on? So if humanity is looking for a true religion that is from God, then that religion is the religion of Islam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.